for joining us. This is the KT Connects webinar hosted by the Michael Smith Foundation for Health Research, Arthritis Research Canada, and the BC Support Unit. It is my pleasure to introduce Colleen McGavin, who is here today to present on patient-oriented research, the intersection of patient engagement and knowledge translation. Colleen is the patient engagement lead for the BC Support Unit. In this capacity, she is responsible for leading the development and implementation of the unit's patient engagement strategy. Before becoming involved in health research, she taught courses in business for 25 years at Camosun College in Victoria. Colleen has extensive experience as a cancer patient and family caregiver, and since 2010 has been a volunteer with Patient Voices Network, lending her voice to a variety of quality improvement efforts. She is also a patient partner in several health research teams, helping to shape the research to ensure it reflects problems that are of concern to patients and that measure outcomes that matter to patients. So thank you, Colleen, for being here. I'm going to pass the presentation over to you now.
Okay, hi everyone. It's a pleasure to be here, and I want to start by thanking the Michael Smith Foundation and Arthritis Research Canada for inviting me to be part of the KT Connects webinar series. I want to start off by saying that unlike the other presenters in this series, I'm not an academic researcher. What I've learned about research, patient engagement, and knowledge translation, I've learned, you could say, on the job over the past number of years through personal experience as a cancer patient and family caregiver, as a volunteer in healthcare quality improvement initiatives, as a patient partner on several research teams, and in my role as the patient engagement lead with the BC Support Unit. I really appreciate this opportunity to reflect on what I've learned about knowledge translation and how it relates to patient engagement, and to share those thoughts with you. As Jessica mentioned today, I'm the patient engagement lead for BC's Support Unit. My role at the Support Unit is to lead the development and implementation of the patient engagement strategy. Briefly, the Support Unit, or what we call the unit, is a multi-partner organization created to support, streamline, and increase patient-oriented research throughout BC. Our unit is one of several support units established across the country as part of Canada's Strategy for Patient-Oriented Research, otherwise more commonly known as SPOR, led by the Canadian Institutes of Health Research, or CIHR. Before we go further, let's find out who's tuned in. Jessica, if you could take back control of the presentation so that the participants can make a mark beside the stakeholder group that best describes them. And so everyone, if you could just please put a mark beside the group you identify with primarily. If none of the first four describes you, you can put a mark beside other and then type a description into the chat box. Okay, Jessica, what did people write for other?
We don't have anything in the chat box yet.
Oh, okay. Well, it's good to know that we have a range of people there, lots of researchers, etc. So thanks, everyone. Now, Jessica, if you could advance to the next poll question. Great. I'd like to just get a sense of how you define patient-oriented research in your own mind. So if you could just put a mark beside the answer you think best describes it. Great. You're all getting high marks. Jessica, if you could please pass control of the presentation back to me, that would be great. We can move on. You're right. Patient-oriented research is all of these things within the context of the strategy for patient-oriented research. So to be truly patient-oriented, and so in practical terms, I really think that means to qualify for CIHR funding on any grant call that's part of the SPOR initiative. A research project has to meet all of these tests. I want to spend just a minute talking about the term patient partner. So who is a patient partner? We encounter this, term in various places, and there are several definitions that you might come across. But here it means that if patients are involved in a research project in any manner other than as a research subject, they're considered patient partners. Some roles that patients may take on throughout a research project or associated with a research project include things like participation on governing boards or committees, being consulted on survey design for a study, co-developing the research methodology with a researcher, taking part in priority setting activities to determine new areas of research. These are just some examples. The idea of engaging patients as partners and focusing on patient-identified priorities is relatively new and quite a culture shift, which begs the question, why do we need to do research differently? This statement gets at the heart of what SPOR is all about, Canada's strategy to ensure that the right patient receives the right intervention at the right time. As a patient, when I first encountered this statement, it was a bit unnerving to me to find out that this doesn't necessarily happen all the time. I started out my journey as a cancer patient with implicit faith that my care providers would all be up to speed at all times on the latest information to guide their practice. I now realize that was pretty naive of me. I recently came across this statement in an often quoted article by Ballas and Boren, published in 2000. If a physician were to read just two articles daily, within 1 year, that physician would still fall centuries behind. To read everything of potential biomedical importance, physicians would have to peruse about 6,000 articles a day. I've read other things. Some research suggests that up to 50% of patients do not get treatments of proven effectiveness, and up to 25% get care that's not needed or potentially harmful. In other words, it's not necessarily that scientists and academics haven't done research and don't know what the right approaches are. It's that their knowledge is not making it to those who need it to make good policy and practice decisions. This is one way that CIHR illustrates the challenge. In the same article by Ballas and Borens, they suggest that it takes, on average, 17 years for research evidence to reach clinical practice. And I've heard that only a small fraction of research ever does. There's a second part of this statement, and it outlines the proposed solution. To ensure that the right patient receives the right intervention at the right time, we need to increase the amount of research being conducted with and by research knowledge users. With and by are important words here because typically research is done for and on patients. In the world of researchers, healthcare providers, and health system decision makers, in the world of research, healthcare providers and health system decision makers are the groups that come to mind when we're thinking of knowledge users. But it's important to note that patients and families are included here. So this is the last part of that statement that outlines the proposed solution. This is a very key idea that patients are knowledge users too. First of all, there's been a lot of effort put into promoting patient self-management, especially when it comes to chronic health conditions like diabetes, congestive heart failure, chronic pain, asthma, arthritis, and so on. Patients are encouraged to take responsibility by, for example, eating healthily, exercising, controlling stress, and so on. In this way, patients become partners with their care providers in taking responsibility for their health and well-being. So patients need information about what is healthy for them given their particular circumstances. For example, is it better to exercise or lay off when someone's arthritis is acting up? What's the best diet for someone dealing with diabetes? Is exercise safe for someone with COPD? What evidence is there that medical marijuana can alleviate chronic pain? Also, there are many situations where decisions about care for an individual person are not straightforward. Each treatment option comes with its own set of risks and rewards, and patients and care providers have to work together to make informed, shared decisions that respect an individual's needs, values, and preferences. Total knee replacement may hold the promise of a cure for someone suffering from osteoarthritis, but how does the patient feel about having surgery? What's the downside of taking statin drugs to control cholesterol? And what are some of the other options? Is it safe not to take antibiotics when someone has an uncomplicated urinary tract infection? These are just examples of the kinds of questions patients may have if they're going to be engaged in their own health and become partners in that. The next two slides are really a review of some key concepts from the first webinar in this series by Bev Holmes and Marla Steinberg. There are various definitions, and three are shown here. The first definition might be a bit hard for a layperson to wrap their head around. The second is much simpler and more understandable, and the third I find very intuitive. I've learned that knowledge is the word that's used to describe what researchers produce, and translation is what we need to do in order to make that knowledge understandable to knowledge users, that is, those who need the knowledge in order to make good, evidence-informed decisions. Here's another interesting statistic from the Balance and Boris report I referred to earlier. 75% of physicians admitted having problems understanding statistics commonly found in medical journals. I found it oddly comforting to know that even physicians often have trouble reading medical journals. The authors go on to say, the words of scientists should be presented in ways that are more helpful to those who must translate them into action. And surely this should apply to patients and families as well. Whether a person is self-managing their behaviors and habits in order to stay healthy or manage a chronic illness, or working with their care providers to make informed shared decision, that person needs relevant, timely, and up-to-date health information. And it's important that that information be translated into language that is understandable to the general public, and that it's available in places and by means that the general public can and does access. And this often is the internet. According to the Canadian College of Family Physicians, as of 2010, 80% of Canadian households were connected to the internet, and 70% of Canadians go online to search for medical information. So Bev and Marla talked about there being three main knowledge translation routes. The first one is the researcher push or end of grant route that is primarily consists of publications, conferences, newsletters, websites, that sort of thing. The second route is the knowledge user, or what they call the pull route, where knowledge users engage researchers to find answers to burning questions. So this is engagement up front. And the third route, I advanced that a bit too quickly, but the third route being the integrated route. And they talked about co-creating knowledge and engagement throughout. So patient engagement in patient-oriented research intersects most when we're talking about the third route, the integrated knowledge translation route. So that, considering that third route, segues nicely into this question of what is patient engagement within the context of research. So this is the SPOR definition of patient engagement. And I'd like to break it down because you almost have to examine it word by word to really understand this definition. The first part talks about engagement that is meaningful and active. And there's a quote here from a patient partner. It's the feeling that you're having an impact, that your voice and perspective matter and can influence decisions. And here we're referring to decisions related to a study. It's important. It's design, the protocols, the outcomes to be measured, and so on. The SPOR patient engagement framework includes some guiding principles. There's four guiding principles: inclusiveness, support, mutual respect, and co-build. and they all speak to how we help to ensure that patient engagement is meaningful and active. And by the way, the SPOR patient engagement framework is available online, and I've listed it in the resources, and I would encourage you to go and have a look at it. Next word is collaboration. Many of you may be familiar with this concept of a spectrum of engagement and the idea that as you move from left to right, people have increasing impact on decisions made. It comes from the International Association of Public Participation. And you can see that collaborate, which is used in our definition of patient engagement, is high on the scale of impact. I would say that within the realm of health research, this is aspirational. Not all engagements are at this level. We often talk about partnering, empowering patients, or working collaboratively, but many engagements are still at the consult level, which is fine. But moving engagements more towards the right is part of the culture shift that we're working on at the support unit. The next word in the definition is in governance. So this is just intended to be an illustration of a sort of generic governance model. Governance refers to all the voices, in the sense that I'm thinking of it, governance refers to all the voices that go into decision making about policy, funding, funding allocation, and operations. So, for example, at the support unit, we are recruiting a patient member. We have a patient council that gives advice on the day-to-day operations of the unit. And we're in the process of recruiting a patient partner to sit on the board of our parent organization, the Academic Health Sciences Network. From time to time, we pull together ad hoc advisory groups when we need to call on people with some kind of special experience or expertise. One key point that's illustrated here is that one or two patients can't represent all patients. So you need to have a governance structure that enables the inclusion of many patient voices. There's an article called Is It Worth It? Patient and Public Views on the Impact of Their Involvement in Health Research and its Assessment. It's a UK-based qualitative interview study, and it enumerates a few of the ways that patients can bring value in governance. I've listed three of them here. They can be creative outsiders and free challengers. They're freer to think creatively and challenge assumptions because they're not pressured by being peers or being part of the organization or outside of the organization. I like the one about passive presence. I think of it as kind of like the picture of the queen on the wall. The patient present reminds others of what this work that we're all involved in is all about, keeping it patient-centered versus system-centered. And then we go on in the definition, engagement and priority setting. I've been taught that a good research question is FINER. This is an acronym. It stands for feasible, interesting, novel, ethical, and relevant. But the question becomes, in my mind, who is the question interesting to, and who is it relevant to? So first we have the priorities of academic researchers. Well, traditionally, it's been researchers who have set the agenda. A lot of CIHR funding is investigator-initiated versus some funds that they've set aside for priority-driven research. Health system decision makers have their priorities as well. And this is the knowledge user poll route mentioned earlier, where policymakers and funders engage researchers to find answers to important burning questions. It could be health system decision makers might want research focused on priority populations. It could be a small population taking up an inordinate amount of system resources. I think healthcare providers also have priorities that they would like for things they would like to have researched, and they may have a slightly different emphasis depending on their demographics or so on. But what about patient priorities? So this is an illustration that I've been referring to for some time, and I want you to notice that it comes from an article published in 2000. So this is some while ago, but it does illustrate how there can be a disconnect between patient priorities and where we're putting our resources in terms of research. So in this article by Talon et al, only 9% of patients wanted more research on drugs, yet over 80% of randomized controlled trials in patients with osteoarthritis of the knee were drug evaluations. Now, I want to acknowledge that I'm sure that Arthritis Research Canada, with its strong patient advisory group, has done a lot to inform the research agenda for osteoarthritis. And this case that I brought up here is just to illustrate a point. And in the next part of the definition, which talks about patient engagement in the conduct of research itself and in knowledge translation. So here there's an illustration of a typical research life cycle or process with the steps along the way. There's a person named Isabella Zelast, who is a research facilitator with the College of Medicine at the University of Saskatchewan, and she developed a really useful document that we've been using with researchers to outline some of the roles for patients at all phases of the research life cycle. She lists literally dozens of ways patients can get involved, but I'll just highlight a few. So in the design phase, patients can co-develop patient recruitment strategies, they can review and comment on proposed questionnaires and data collection methods. In the development of the grant proposal, they can help to define outcome measures that are important to patients. In the preparation for the execution of the study, patients can assist with writing patient information and consent forms. At the or during the data collection phase, patients can conduct peer interviews and focus groups. When analyzing and interpreting data, patients can be consulted to determine if they understand and interpret data the same way as the research team. When it comes time to disseminate the research results, patients can advise on different avenues. They can even co-author manuscripts, newsletters, and other appropriate information outlets, and they can jointly present the findings with researchers. With regard to implementation, patient involvement can increase the likelihood that results of research are implemented by adding validity to the findings, and throughout, patients can help with monitoring and evaluating the research process. And there are many other ideas in this document by Isabella Zelast, and again, I've included it in the list of resources for this webinar. So to summarize, some of the ideas around why we might want to engage with patients. It started with the moral argument that, maybe 20 or 30 years ago, that people have a right to be involved in publicly funded endeavors that affect them personally. I hope I've illustrated that we need a greater impact from research on policy and practice change. And that as knowledge users, patients know what matters to them and which treatments and therapies are most likely to be acceptable to them, so it can help to make the research more relevant. There's a quality argument as well, that patients bring a unique perspective that complements scientific and academic expertise. It does not replace it, but it complements it. And there are also benefits to both patients and researchers. Much has been written that I've read by the researchers and patients who have been involved and have worked together on research projects, and they've talked about the personal benefits and the benefits to the research. So recognizing patients and the public as knowledge users and engaging patients in health research is definitely still the road less traveled. It can be complex and challenging, but ultimately worth it. According to Marla, in the commentary at the end of that webinar, most researchers say it's the most effective way. And if your goal is to produce useful information that can be applied and make change, it's the route to go. Now that I've hopefully made that point and clarified what patient engagement means within the context of SPOR, I'd like to describe what I've learned about knowledge translation in what I hope you'll find a creative and engaging way, call it a layperson's bird's eye view. The bulk of my presentation from here on builds on a metaphor that was introduced by Bev and Marla in the first webinar, the metaphor of knowledge translation as a journey. It's a wonderful metaphor, and I thank them for spurring my thinking as I prepared this presentation about the intersection of patient engagement and knowledge translation. Like many travel stories, a map is useful to describe the journey, and here's a map that I hope will help to explain the KT journey as a layperson might see it. The map shows two routes. One is a well-used road called End of Grant. The other is a winding path called Integrated. End of Grant, you'll notice, is paved for most of the way, but bogs down after dissemination. There's that Death Valley we talked about, where we mentioned that only a small percentage of the knowledge generated makes it up here to action. And even, you know, it takes years to do so. Integrated is a trail cut through the woods with pitfalls and switchbacks. It takes longer to get to knowledge, but getting to action is more assured. We're learning that if action is your ultimate goal, integrated is the route to go. Now, action is the home of knowledge users. Knowledge users are, as we said, those who need the knowledge produced by research to make good, evidence-informed decisions. The more established neighborhoods of action are populated largely by healthcare policymakers and healthcare providers, but fairly recently, patients have taken up residence too, mostly on the fringes, creating bewilderment and even discomfort in some circles, especially those who believe it is their job to make good decisions for patients and the public. It's believed that the benefits of evidence-informed decisions made in action will eventually flow into better patient experience, better patient outcomes, and a more sustainable healthcare system. This vision of the future I've called the land of EOS. Now, it's a bit ironic that I named this utopic place EOS, which, if you didn't get it, is an acronym for experience, outcomes, and sustainability. Those who know me well know I avoid acronyms whenever possible. Before I go on, just as a little aside, I want to mention that EOS is also the name of the Greek goddess of the dawn, which I didn't realize at first, but it sounded like it should be a Greek word, so I looked it up. And in the end, I thought it was a fitting metaphor too, because of how the dawn represents new beginnings and to a certain extent, transformation. And I think we all know that we need to do something transformative in healthcare. So back to the start. Regardless of which route you take, the journey starts in priority, traditionally the home of researchers. Priority is where the big decisions are made, like what are the important things to study. Many researchers are only familiar with the end of grant route, so let's see what happens when that path is chosen. And I'm going to try to use a feature of this. No, I'm not going to be able to use it, sorry. So in priority, researchers begin to form teams. We know that research requires a team effort, and the most successful teams are those that bring together the necessary expertise. Most often, a team forms around scientific and academic expertise. In this scenario, patients are viewed primarily as study subjects, the people for whom and on whom research is done. From priority, the journey takes the team to design. There, the priority is refined into a specific research question or multiple related questions, depending on the complexity of the project, and research methods are chosen. Along the way, the team will likely need to pick up more members, once again, to ensure that they have the necessary scientific or academic expertise. The next stop is proposal. Without a convincing proposal that outlines important considerations like what outcomes are going to be measured and the chances of proceeding much further are limited. With luck and skill, The team will have success getting to the next stop, funding, the home of granting agencies. But the road along here is subject to washout. To this point, the journey is risky. Even though there's a lot of money for research, it's never enough to fund all the teams, and there's no guarantee that the efforts of an individual team will be rewarded. Unsuccessful teams may disband, but some return to design, taking what they've learned thus far in an attempt to try again. If successful, there's celebration and the team is rewarded, not only by virtue of being funded, but by recognition from their peers. They may now progress on their journey, passing through data collection, analysis, and on to knowledge. I imagine the mood during this part of the journey is generally upbeat with knowledge in sight. Knowledge is characterized by mountainous stores of information, some of which is locked up in vaults where one must pay to access it. A lot of it is collecting dust on shelves. As Bev pointed out, this is not necessarily a bad thing. Many researchers are working on issues that haven't yet attracted the attention of policymakers. So if there's already research, a window opens up and they may get invited to present. Just beyond knowledge is dissemination, where attempts are made to transmit or broadcast the knowledge gained through research up to action. Researchers stay for a time in old but respected hotels named publication and presentation, as well as newer places called website, newsletter, and social media. Now, I don't mean to dismiss these methods because, again, as Beth pointed out, sometimes that's how knowledge is best shared. And certainly publishing and presenting are what researchers are most rewarded for. But because of that volume of knowledge coming out of dissemination, and because it's often expressed in language that's hard to understand by non-academics, the chances that it will reach action are limited. Visiting dissemination is a requirement for any research team to achieve funding, and much recognition and celebration goes on there as well. However, having been rewarded for their efforts, team members are often anxious to return to priority to begin the journey again. Now, I've just described the typical journey down the end of grant route, but as I said, there's a route less traveled. It's not paved, it takes longer to get anywhere, it's dotted with obstacles and switchbacks. It has its share of frustrations and surprises, some disappointing and some very pleasant. It's still shrouded in mystery, and I would say most suited for those who value intrinsic rewards in addition to the usual. The determining factor of whether you're going to take end of grant or the integrated route is whether you decide to take knowledge users, including patients, along on the journey. Now, why would a researcher want to do that? Well, some granting agencies in funding now require it, which is a powerful incentive. This is partly because of political pressure from patients and the public who believe that they have a right to be involved in publicly funded endeavors that affect them personally. Sometimes it's because researchers have found that patients actually have something to contribute that complements the researcher's scientific or academic knowledge. That is, that patients are expert in what it's like to actually live with their condition and that they have an understanding of their own needs, values, preferences, and risk tolerances when it comes to treatment options. In other words, as knowledge users, patients know what matters to them and which treatments and therapies are most likely to be acceptable to them. So they're best placed to speak to the outcomes that matter most to them. And those outcomes are not always those that are traditionally measured. The researchers see the advantages of using patients to design study protocols that will be acceptable to other patients so that recruiting study subjects is easier and more ethical. Patients are able to help broadcast research results in a way that users can understand because they are users. Researchers have found that involving patients has made them better communicators, and that taking all of these factors into account has made research more relevant and more likely to be implemented. Patient engagement on research teams necessarily means taking a different path, where less is known about how to get it right. But that's what we're working on at the support unit. We're trying to map the territory, set up a guide service, and create some guidebooks. And like Bab and Marla, I'd also like to offer some tips for travel along the integrated route. So the first one is avoid tokenism. I think of this as a nasty critter that generally shows up early on the journey. If you get bitten by tokenism, you may make it to funding, but the way to action is no more assured than if you had taken the paved route. Think carefully about roles and responsibilities ahead of time. Tools like Isabella Zaleski's list of roles for patients can be very, very helpful. A journey down the integrated path will require some new tools. The ability to work collaboratively in partnership with less of an attitude of competitiveness. You may need to give up a bit of control. As Marla says, at times it's organized chaos and you have to be comfortable with ambiguity. The third bullet speaks to the issue of legitimacy and representativeness. One or two patients cannot represent all patients, so make sure patients on your team are connected to more patients in their community. Start early. It takes time. Now, there's one catch here. By and large, research funders don't fund the activities that need to occur before research teams get to funding. For example, meeting costs. I've been encouraged by some talk about how that might change. Budget thoughtfully. Think carefully about how you're going to support everyone along the way. What do team members need in order to stay motivated and strong? Do they need training before they begin and along the way? Do patient partners need childcare or reimbursement for their out-of-pocket expenses? How about honoraria or other kinds of rewards like financial support to co-present at a conference? Ask patient partners what they value about being engaged. It will likely not be the same thing that researchers or other members of the team value, for example, career development through publishing and presenting. Avoid acronyms and technical language. These are pesky creatures. They're less dangerous than tokenism, but they can cause breakdowns due to poor communications and the way they induce feelings of separation and power imbalance. And finally, be mentally prepared for surprises, mostly pleasant ones, I'm happy to report. There was a scoping review published in 2015 in England that looked at six disease areas. They did an online survey of researchers. They followed 22 studies for 18 months. They interviewed 206 people. And I'd just like to share a few quotes from that report. For lay respondents, in other words, the patients and the public who were involved, they reported that it was overwhelmingly a positive experience. In terms of the researchers, they say that the depth of positive experience was illustrated by the often used religious metaphors of patient and public involvement being like an epiphany or a Damascene moment. So I think you can expect some pleasant surprises like that along the route. So I'll just end with a few key messages or points that I hope you've taken away from this presentation. The first is that I hope I've made the point that patients are knowledge users too. I've learned that when people think of knowledge users, they often think of health system decision makers or policy makers and perhaps of healthcare providers. But I trust I've made the point that patients are knowledge users too. The second point I'd really like to emphasize is that patients' lived experience complements academic and scientific knowledge. It does not replace it. And finally, that patient-oriented research is the place where patient engagement, as it's defined within the context of the strategy for patient-oriented research and knowledge translation, intersect. So I'll end there and turn control, I guess, back over to you, Jessica.
Yes, thank you very much, Colleen. That was a very thought-provoking webinar, and I have to say that there was some really engaging discussion among the participants during your presentation, and we have a number of really interesting questions. So I'm going to start off our question and answer period with, how is a patient defined?
Okay, that's a really good question. I wasn't too sure how much detail around that to put into the webinar. Within the context of SPOR, and I think this is quite consistent with other groups, the definition includes the idea that a patient is someone with lived experience of the health system or health condition, and the term automatically includes family and informal caregivers as well. And I also want to mention that the term patient, while I use it consistently throughout when I'm speaking, and I've used it consistently within this presentation, a lot of people are not comfortable with that term patient, or they use other terms. So other ones that I've heard are things like client, consumer, people with, and then fill in the blank is often used as well. So people with lived experience, people with HIV, people with arthritis, client, service user. Sometimes people use the term community when they're talking about what I would refer to as patients, when they're trying to connect with organizations that represent people with lived experience of the healthcare system. So just to sum up, then our definition within the context of SPOR is individuals with lived experience of a health condition, and it automatically includes informal caregivers like such as family.
Wonderful. That's really helpful. Thank you, Colleen. Next question from the participants is, who can become a patient rep or a patient partner?
Well, the word can sort of to me connotes like who qualifies or who's eligible, and maybe I've already answered that within the definition of patient. Sometimes it's argued, I'll just add to that, sometimes it's argued that we're all patients by virtue of the fact that at some point or other we've all interacted with the healthcare system, and many of us have lived experience in one way or another, or we're related to someone or an informal caregiver for someone who has that lived experience. But I think within the context of a given project or initiative, the idea of someone who has relevant lived experience is really important. So if you're looking to who to partner with on a particular project and you're looking for a, quote, patient, you would want to be looking for someone who has relevant lived experience to the project at hand.
Excellent. Thank you. Another question came from the group, which was, how can we engage and support underserved groups?
This is a huge question, and I have to confess that it's something that we're learning at the support unit. We need to do more around engaging underserved, I've heard various terms used, vulnerable, marginalized, voices less heard, within research and within the support unit itself. We need to learn a lot more about how to reach out to those groups and what's different about working with those groups. I think that we've been going after sort of the low-hanging fruit, people who are easy to engage with by virtue of various qualities or qualifications that they might have. And we need to do a lot more work around engaging with those voices less heard is the phrase that always comes to mind for me. Some of the things that I've picked up from talking to people is meeting people where they're at, not expecting people always to come to us and work within a context that's comfortable and familiar. To be more concrete about that, you know, always available 9 to 5, Monday to Friday, come to our office, meet with us on our ground, our turf. But going out and meeting people where they're at and being somewhat humble, I think, about talking to them about how to, and learning from them and admitting what we don't know about working with them.
Right. This next question comes from the recognition that it can take several years for a research question to produce answers and become usable in practice. So how can patient group involvement be sustained?
I think this is a huge challenge of patient engagement in research, and I think that one of the ways to mitigate that challenge is to be very upfront with patient partners about this. And I think to do the groundwork around relationship building and working very hard to stay in constant communication with people about where the project is at. A really wonderful example of that, as far as I'm concerned, is the, if anyone would like to go to the website for this project, it's called Tech for Home. It's spelled T-E-C, the number four, home, where they do a great job of constantly keeping everyone involved in the project up to date on the project through regular newsletters, for example, about where things are at. But yeah, that can be a huge challenge, because you can have periods of time when there's a flurry of activity, for example, when you're developing the grant proposal and submitting, and then a big gap while you're waiting to find out if it's been approved and so on. And just keeping in touch with people and being upfront and letting them know that they can expect that, I think that's really helpful.
Wonderful. And the next question challenges a little bit whether the term perspective is the best language to use when describing what patients bring to a research project.
The term perspective?
Yes. Whether that's the best language to use to describe the value, let's say, that patients bring to a research project.
So when I use the word patient perspective or the phrase patient perspective, I'm using it in a sort of broad sense of that encompasses the patient's experience, their views that are based on their experience, and that it is something that is added into the mix along with the perspectives, if you will, or the experience, the skills, the training, the views of all of the other members of the research team. So that's how I'm using the term or the phrase patient perspective. I'm not sure if, you know, I'd be happy to hear if someone has an alternative term that perhaps better describes that.
Great, thank you very much for addressing that. We do have time for a couple more questions, and I do have a two-part question next. Cheryl asks, how many patients should you involve to get a clear understanding of their perspective on a certain topic, and can multiple patient perspectives negatively impact the research?
So the question of how many patients to involve does come up quite commonly, and, you know, oftentimes when I'm starting to work with a research team that wants to do patient engagement, they're thinking in terms of one or two patients to provide that perspective. And as I mentioned in the webinar, one or two people can never represent all patients with experience with a certain condition or health issue or topic. So as I described on the governance slide, I think it's really important that you somehow are able to connect your patient partners who might be part of the research team with other patients. Now, that could be by virtue of reaching out to a group, an organization that represents that particular or has a lot of contacts. It could be by having the occasional survey, focus group, somehow getting the views of multiple patients. And I, in terms of whether multiple perspectives can harm the research, can you repeat that second part of that question, Jessica?
Of course. So the question is, can multiple patient perspectives negatively impact the research?
So I'm not exactly sure if that's multiple perspectives on the or views on the team, or whether you're the person who's asking the question is asking whether when you reach out to larger groups and you get multiple perspectives, I think you know, I don't see it as a negative. I see it as something that it may raise questions that then, you know, is one of those switchbacks along the route that you maybe have to pause and say, okay, we've got some divergence of opinion here. We've got a question that we just can't barrel through here. We have to stop and pause and find out how we resolve these differences that are coming up at this point.
Wonderful, thank you. And I'm actually just going to close off the Q&A period with a final question. Colleen, if you could answer, what services will the BC Support Unit provide in terms of patient engagement and knowledge translation?
I'm going to speak primarily to the patient engagement side of it, because we have others in the support unit who are probably better voices in terms of services around knowledge translation. But the services that we're providing at the support unit now include helping research teams to recruit patient partners, to identify and recruit patient partners. We're working with research teams to help them to develop their patient engagement plans, so working through questions like, what will the roles and responsibilities of the patients be on the team? Helping them work through logistical issues around providing information to the patient partners around how often does the team meet, who else is on the team, how will communication take place, and so on. So there's a whole range of questions that we work through and discuss in order to come up with a patient engagement plan together. The support unit also offers training in patient-oriented research. We've been working on the development of a national curriculum that consists of three modules of training that are conducted over 2.5 days. And would love to hear from people if they're interested in that training. We're also gearing up to provide guidance on the evaluation of patient engagement within your project. And I'm also really happy to report that we've just completed 3 days of training for patient engagement coordinators in our regional centers throughout the province. So we now have people all around the province in the various health authorities who have now been trained in doing patient engagement. So I did want to mention that if you go to our website, bcsupportunit.ca, there's a green button called Inquiry Form, and you can click on that. And it's very, very quick to register an inquiry if you would like to connect with people who are now ready to offer these services throughout the province.
Perfect. Thank you very much, Colleen. And before we conclude the Q&A session, I do want to just circle back to address one of the questions around how to engage and support underserved groups. We actually have an offer from one of our participants, Cheryl, who's a consumer co-investigator, who's offered to share what she's doing in terms of a patient engagement model and strategy as part of her work on studying underserved populations. So if we're able to connect with Cheryl and get that, we'll be sure to post it along with our other resources from this webinar on the KT Connects webpage of the Michael Smith Foundation website.
That's wonderful. Thank you, Cheryl.
Thank you very much, Cheryl. So everyone, that concludes our question and answer period, but before we wrap up for today, I wanted to sincerely thank our presenter, Colleen, for offering her webinar and sharing her insights with us.
You're very welcome.
Your feedback is incredibly important to us, so please take a few minutes to share your thoughts on today's webinar. A link to the brief survey has been added to the chat box, and it will also be shared via email after the webinar. Your comments and suggestions will help us to improve future webinars. For more information about KT and to explore supplemental resources, these links have been provided for your convenience. One final reminder that all of our webinars will be recorded and are archived along with presentation slides and additional resources at www.msfhr.org/KTConnects. And you can expect to see the archive recording of today's webinar posted by Monday, January 30th. So we hope that you'll consider joining us for our next webinar entitled Commitment Issues, How to Get My Community Organization to Say Yes to an Integrated KT Project. And this will be presented by Chris McBride on Friday, February 24th at 12 p.m. Pacific Time. I'd also like to draw your attention to a recent blog post written by Chris McBride for the MSMHR KT blog, which will nicely accompany his upcoming webinar. You can find it on that same link on the screen, the KT Connect webpage. That concludes our webinar for today. For everyone on the line, we want to thank you again for joining us. We hope you'll join us again on February 24th with guest speaker Chris McBride. Have a fantastic day. You're now free to disconnect.